moderate this conversation regarding the new splendid Roberto Bolle's book, which is titled Viaggio nella bellezza, Voyage into Beauty, is published by Rizzoli, and it features, in addition to a portfolio of photographs of Luciano Romano, a wonderful selection of photographs done by Fabrizio Ferri, who's here with us tonight, and the cover by Fabrizio speaks for itself. Let me introduce briefly Fabrizio. Fabrizio is one of Italy's most renowned international photographers with a long time commitment with American Ballet Theatre. During a prolific career, which has spanned over 30 years, he has captured the beauty, the soul, the sensuality of many celebrities and many dancers, including, of course, Roberto. And his work has been featured in international publications such as Vogue and Vanity Fair. He's also, Fabrizio is also a modern version of a Renaissance man. He's a music composer, he's a writer, he's a video artist, he's a director, and most important here is longtime Roberto's friend and great collaborator, so a partner in crime, I would say. So we are particularly happy to have him here tonight to share and discuss the project of the creation of this book project, along with other collaboration that they did together. Although you might not need any other introduction, I would like to tell you a couple of things about Roberto. We all know his stellar career, principal dancer at ABT. Don't miss him on June 20th for his performance in Romeo and Juliet at ABT. His étoile at Teatro La Scala in Milan when he wore, studied when he was very young, and he's still very young and beautiful. And also, Roberto has danced the most important roles in the classic repertoire in the most famous prestigious theaters all over the world. And he's also collaborated with visionaries, avant-gardist visionaries like Bob Wilson and Peter Greenaway. What we don't know yet, and we will probably discover soon, is that Roberto has become one of the most famous ambassador of Italian culture. Quoting Robert Wilson, Roberto is the gatekeeper of Italian culture. In fact, with the aim of bringing the ballet to a wider audience, Roberto presented his gala, Roberto Bolle and Friends, in the most spectacular locations and archaeological sites in Italy, all supported by UNESCO. And UNESCO awarded Roberto with a gold medallion in recognition of the cultural and universal value of his artistic work. So, after this long introduction, let me ask you, Roberto, the first question. Can you please tell us a little bit more about Roberto Bolle and Friends and the peculiarity of this gala?
Yes. You can hear otherwise.
Nothing at all?
Nothing. Okay, this is the microphone.
Now it works.
Okay.
Magic.
So, Robert, I created the gala Roberto Bolle in France about 15 years ago. About 15 years ago. And that's because I wanted to have my own show. I wanted to perform outside the major theater like La Scala or Opera di Roma or San Carlo in Naples. And I wanted to perform for a different audience. So of course the gala performance was the right format because we didn't need to have major set or costumes or a corps de ballet. But what we really need was to have good dancers. So the main things was the quality of dance, the quality of the artist, and the quality of the choreography, of course. So we created this show, Roberto Bolle in France, and at the beginning we started to perform in very small venues. ended eventually in a big plaza like the main square in Milan, Piazza Duomo, or Piazza dei Plebisciti, which is the main square in Naples, so really in an amazing location. And at the same time, we started also the partnership with the FAI, which is the Italian National Trust for the Environment. And thanks to them, we were able to bring the show in a magical place like the Colosseum in Rome, the Temple Valley in Agrigento, in Sicily, and many others. Was really quite an extraordinary journey, actually.
So how did the idea of this book come about?
Well, actually, because of, I mean, at one point I really realized how incredible and how extraordinary was all the journey I did with Roberto Bolle and friends, and I wanted to share that journey into beauty, because it's, I mean, some of these places like the Colosseum or even the big piazza in Milano, in this place that's never been performed like a ballet performance, so it was the first time ever. And I think the beauty of the dance and the beauty of the venue, they exalt one the other, and they create something really extraordinary that you can see in these those images.
I think that performing ballet outside of the regular theater, because you know what, one thing is to see Roberto dancing, for instance, at La Scala Theater or at ABT. One thing is to see him dancing in front of the of a wonderful Greek temple in Agrigento in Sicily. So performing ballet outside of the regular venues of a theater is quite ambitious. So what kind of obstacles did you encounter along the way, and or what kind of unexpected joy and benefit did you find?
Well, it was a really a big challenge to bring ballet evening in this venue, because never, as I said, it was never performed before in Piazza Duomo or Piazza del Plebiscito. But even in arena in Verona, there is a big arena where every summer from mid-June till beginning of September, they perform, there is a very important festival, and they perform opera, the most well-known opera. And until 20 years ago, they used to perform as well ballet, like at least one full-length ballet, like Romeo and Juliet or Swan Lake, or even major company like Béjart Ballet was invited to perform there. But that was until 20 years ago. So I wanted to bring my gala there in the arena, but actually the artistic direction didn't want to take, because it was too risky for them, because they were afraid not to sell enough tickets, because there are like between 13 and 14,000 seats, so it's really a big venue.
Okay.
So I decided to take the risk, so we did our own production there outside the festival, mm-hmm. and we had like 10,000 people attending the show, so it was quite a good success. And the following year, the arena asked me to be inside of the festival, and the house was full, and that was last year. So this year we are going to go there,
again
in July. So it's not easy, but
it can happen. And can you tell us the difference between dancing in, let's say, also en plein air, because you're not in a closed structure, and the difference between dancing en plein air and performing in a more structured and more traditional environment?
Yeah, it's very difficult to perform outside in outdoor spaces like the one we're talking about, because as a dancer, we're very used to the theater, to warm up properly, to have marble floors, so really particular type of floor and with said lighting and everything is under control in outdoor and open air spaces. You don't have this facility at all, so most of the time we ended up warming up in under on stones because we didn't have any other place to warm up, and many times it's too cold, it's windy, it's raining. It's a big challenge because I mean you have to keep your best, and it's you know, I mean, people are there to see a wonderful show, but sometimes you are not in the condition to give the best. So it's really.
But you always give the best.
We try, yes.
Okay, let's enjoy a selection of these wonderful alternative stages that they are featured in the book. So we have here Roberto dancing in the bubbly gardens in Florence. That was 2009, right?
Yes.
Look at him. Right. And this is the Bath of Caracalla, which is another location that you really like because you performed there several times.
Many times, mm-hmm. Yes, in Rome. It's a beautiful, I mean, it's an amazing place. Like
sometimes the space also determine the selection of a ballet, or you can play or you can dance whatever you want in every place.
No, I always select what I want to dance, and like in Caracalla, actually, I've been there like three times, mm-hmm. at least. So of course I choose to dance different pieces every year, to have a different repertoire, and to invite also different artists to perform there. So it's because public, I mean, comes to see maybe every year the show, so they expect something different
every time. So we have the Caracalla, the Bath of Caracalla. This is the Greek theater of Taormina in Sicily, which is another incredible location. And this is the arena of Verona that was taken in 2012. And if you are in Italy in July, he's going to perform again,
yes.
Right?
And all these photos are from our Luciano Romano.
Yes,
photo.
And these are yes. This section are Luciano Romano, and then we're gonna go to Fabrizio Portfolio later on. So among all the places that in which you have performed, you have danced, which is the most the most emotional one, the unforgettable, and why?
Well, for sure, the Colosseum in Rome was unforgettable. The Piazza Duomo in Milano, I mean, Piazza Duomo, I felt like to be more a pop star than a ballet dancer because there were like 50,000 people in the piazza, was really full of people.
Wow.
And it was really something incredible. Mm-hmm. And another one, I mean, in Sicily, in the Tempio Concordia, there was really special because we had the possibility to build the stage in front of the temple, and it's something that never happened before and will never happen again because we have this special permission thanks to FAI, as I said, which is an Italian National Trust for the Environment. So I remember the moment I started the show with Apollo, so I performed Apollo. So I remember the moment I was in between the big column of the temple, and I was walking
yes.
through the column to go and reach the stage, and that moment was really beyond the time and the space. It was really something so special and so unique that I will never forget.
Okay, the book that you're gonna see and you're gonna buy soon, I hope, is an enthusiastic, passionate record of Roberto's encounter with the most famous historical Italian landmarks. And I like the book for different reasons, because first of all, turning the pages, I actually can feel it, you can feel as well, and almost touch the strong and vital relationship between the past and the present, and the engaging dialogue between energy and movement harmony and proportion. And it's also very interesting for me to see how ballet and classic art are based on the same principle, pure perfection and beauty. I also found interesting the two paces that the book offers. Because in one section with the photo of Luciano Romano, we have Roberto photographed, captured while he's dancing. While in the other, you know, in the other section, in Fabrizio's portfolio, Roberto seems blend. Who's gonna start the seems blend into the beautiful frescoes and the amazing ruins of one of the most striking archaeological sites in Italy, which is Pompeii. So, why Pompeii? This is a question that I'm asking both of you, and for finally to you, Fabrizio, what is the inspiration behind this wonderful, emotional, striking portfolio? Pompeii.
Well, Pompeii is a iconic place, and it's the beauty, the art, the culture is everything. And I thought it was right to start this journey from Pompeii. And I never get tired to tell how important is in this particular time, in particular historical moment, to give the right value to our resources, which are the culture and art. So we have really to give it the good value. So I wanted to start from Pompeii because it's a place I have not performed yet, but it's one of the most iconic and magical places in Italy and in the world.
Fabrizio, the inspiration behind this portfolio?
Well, first of all, when Roberto called me with the question, would you like to do a book with me in Pompeii? As you can imagine, it took a long time to make the decision. And as far as inspiration, I may disillude you, but the inspiration was based on the difficulty of the project. Because even if it looks or it sounds like an easy task, going with Roberto to Pompeii and imagining the work that we were going to perform was very difficult, because everything I tried to envision was Roberto in front of Pompeii, and I knew that wouldn't work. I knew that I had to find a way to, as to use your word, to blend the two beauties, the two symbols of eternity that are Roberto's beauty and talent and Pompeii. There is something so emotional in Pompeii. I don't know how many of you have had the luck to, the luxury to visit those ruins, that witness the life 2,000 years ago. But we had to come up with something that brought that history to the present, made the past into the present, so that Roberto would fit right in and own it and be the protagonist with Pompeii of the images, not in front of them.
How much did the project, how much time did this project take to finish?
I think it was 2 days. 2 days.
Fast.
4 days, fast.
Well, but probably you thought a lot about it, you know.
A lot
of thinking. And so how was your relationship with Fabrizio you met several years ago.
Yes.
And
several years ago, I think it was about 15 years ago, and in La Scala first, because I was dancing with Alessandra Ferri. We all know Alessandra, and Fabrizio, yeah, did some shooting, the two of us first, and then after he photographed, I would photograph by myself, and then we did several projects during the year, and of course we have a really strong artistic partnership and friendship, and what I really like of Fabrizio is his unique sensitivity and his vision, because he has a really a vision that no one has, and he can portray you like no one else, because he's like he's unique. He has this soul, this heart.
I agree.
So it's Fabrizio.
Let's have a look of this amazing portfolio, so we can see what Fabrizio meant to tell. See, I mean, I don't know if you are familiar with Pompeii. Pompeii is and. Wonderful archaeological site outside of Naples. It was destroyed in the first century AD with an eruption of the Mount Vesuvius, and it was preserved almost intact over 1,000 years. And it was discovered in the excavation started in 18th century, and Pompeii was put in the Grand Tour map. So it was also popular here and was a destination of the Grand Tour. And for instance, Herman Melville, your great writer, Moby Dick's writer, Herman Melville, once said that he preferred Pompeii to Paris, just to give you an idea. Pompeii is really magical. So let's see. See? I mean, I like the difference, I like the variety of the settings, because we can actually tour Pompeii. Here, Fabrizio, for instance, who looks like a mythological character, a victim of some sacrifice, or some Greek sacrifice, is just in front of the Temple of Venus, which is one of the best attraction of Pompeii. Everything is great there. I like that. That is, I like also the fact that you are kind of dirty. I mean, you're not. No, you think of Roberto as a Greek god, and I like the fact that you are. And we're gonna see something even more dirty in a video that we will project soon. So, I like that. Right? You like that? And I like that, Fabrizio. Can you tell us something about this photograph, because it's quite iconic.
This is very dear to me, this very picture, because there is pain. And pain goes with the work of Roberto, with his training, with his struggle to always be at his best. But it's also the symbol of the pain of the end of Pompeii. There is a wonderful cast in Pompeii that was found and dug out of the ashes, which is in a man in a shape that is very similar to this one. And he's dirty, yes, because we...
and we like that. Because he's real.
Rolling into that earth of Pompeii, yes. it just...
It's palpable, yeah. Yes. Roberto, you mentioned before that you never danced in Pompeii, so this is, you're going to debut there soon,
yes.
On July 25th,
July
right?
25th, yes.
What are you going to bring there?
And I'm going to do the Roberto Bolle in France, and I'm going to dance several pieces from classical, the one Excelsior, which is the iconic Italian piece, classical piece, to Apollo, of course, by Balanchine, and a few other more contemporary from John Neumeier, and what else I'm gonna dance, and then another, yes, the Bubenicek, which is a trio for three men, with the touch bell music, so different from classical to contemporary, very different rap. And I mean, I'm really excited to go there. There is a beautiful theater, the Teatro Grande, yes, in Pompeii.
And you, and
inside the ruin, yes, inside the site, this archaeological site. And we've been there when we were shooting, of course, to see the space, and it's really magical. It's, I think, would be an unforgettable performance, an unforgettable evening. So I'm really happy because it's the first time that I'm invited. Yes.
So book your trip to Italy, 25th of July, Don Roberto. And here, you know, another Roberto has a Greek stature, like this Copulus, more or less. Roberto again, and I personally really like this photograph because he looks like a Roman aristocrat, and he's in one of the best preserved villas that we have in Pompeii, Villa dei Misteri, the Villa of the Mysteries, and I like. How many times did you photograph Roberto? Do you remember, Fabrizio?
Maybe 20 times. A lot of times, maybe more. I have no idea.
About
20 times.
Because, okay, I have a couple of questions for you. First, Roberto, Martha Graham once said that there is no such thing, I really like this one, there is no such thing as no movement. Sometimes when we are really still, we become more aware of movement. So, Roberto, do you feel you feel yourself at ease in front of the camera, or that requires a different kind of focus or self-consciousness? Since he's a dancer, so he is able to...
But because I'm a dancer, actually, I have, as a dancer, we have awareness of our body that is, it is pretty unmatched, so it's actually quite easy to be in front of the camera because we know so well our body, and most of the time it's quite fun. I mean, I like when there is an artist in front of me. I mean, not a photographer, but someone that can have a different energy, very high quality, so it can create a masterpiece, something really unique, like in this photo.
Yes. And Fabrizio, as I mentioned before, you established a long time relationship with the American Ballet Theatre, so photographing all the dancers and all the posters. What kind of challenge that is present to photograph dancer year after year, and how has this work deepened your appreciation for the body?
First of all, you get spoiled because you work with bodies that are the result of so much work. So they're really sculpted. It's different from the bodies of models or famous actors and actresses. It's a whole different thing. The interesting part of working for 10 years now with the American Ballet Theatre, though, is that when you photograph, it's a different media than live performance. So no matter how high you can ask a dancer to jump, when you do click, he's still. Mm-hmm. So he loses a point. So what I try to do is to preserve the energy and the humanity of the dancer. Something that on stage maybe is not so obvious, the humanity, it's more the role that appears. I try to avoid jumps, typical steps from ballet. Yes.
Roberto already told us what he likes, why he likes working with you. So what do you like about Roberto? How do you like working with him?
The thing I like the most in Roberto is the reason that makes us such good friends. I really love him as a man. I think he's a great young man. And with this extraordinary talent that does not throw a shadow on his humanity. Mm-hmm. I mean, his humanity comes first. It's as long as you know him, you know that. And I think to me, I don't get carried away when I see a beautiful body. You have done this for so many years. So, you know, his beauty is extraordinary.
No, yes.
But his inner beauty is what
is moves even more beautiful.
Me and is what really takes my heart.
I agree. And we have a couple of surprises for you now, because photography is not the only medium that they choose to, you know, that they choose and they has chosen as a collaboration. They also work in two, actually, Fabrizio directed Roberto in two powerful videos that I really would like to share with you. And there are special videos because it's a nice blend of Fabrizio's great technical skill and the Roberto's fantastic bravura. The first video is called Passage, and it was shown 2 years ago out of competition at the Venice Biennial. Fabrizio also wrote the score, because Fabrizio, as I told you, is also a music composer, and he wrote a wonderful, passionate tango for this particular video, and which is about passion and love. So can you tell us a little bit the making of you wanna say it? Okay, let's show it first, and then we're gonna make a little comment. Enjoy, it's quite frightening.
Thank you.
Who is the wonderful dancer?
The dancer is Polina Semyonova. It's really beautiful, and with the choreographer here,
yes.
Michael Pagner. It's so emotional for me also to see it every time. It's so strong, and it was amazing, really. I remember shooting was really hard because we did it in 2 days. The first day,
with all that rain,
yes,
and that running.
The first day was about the run, and I remember it was hours running in that warehouse with the concrete and very dirty floor, and I was running barefoot, so it's really hard because after hours, and Fabrizio would say, faster, faster, okay, now we have to run as fast as you can, as fast as
almost out of breath.
Wow, I mean, I couldn't walk at the end of the day, really, I was so painful.
When did you shoot it? Where? Sorry.
In a warehouse in Red Hook. Mm-hmm.
And the second day was all about this rain, and so we were dancing under the cold water. The water was cold because there was
the boiler didn't work. So.
Yes, it didn't work, and the water was cold. So after hours under this cold water, I mean, I was not sure. I was about to take bronchitis or something. We did like Saturday and Sunday, mm-hmm. And I remember after 2 days on Wednesday, I had my Romeo and Juliet at the Met, because it was during the Met season, of course. And I mean, I was so afraid that I was not able to do anything. The Romeo was really very dangerous, always with Fabrizio.
Always with him. And by the way, are you going to collaborate on a new project soon, or?
For sure, mm-hmm. Yes.
Can we know something, or is still under top secret?
No, we can't say anything.
You can't say anything. But the collaboration will continue. Okay. Okay, I would like to thank you very much. And before say goodbye to you, I would like to finish this conversation with the second video that Fabrizio and Roberto did, which is called Rethink Energy. And that is pure bliss. So with these images, I will thank you very much, and I will leave you, Fabrizio and Roberto, for Buxai. Thank you very much.
Let me just say, something about Passage. When we were working with Marco and Roberto and Polina, and under this cold water, Roberto and Polina, we're going like this, look.
Yeah, I was really
that strong. They couldn't speak. They would try to say, well, do you think you should do this? This bad, but literally this bad. And I said, this is not gonna happen. This is not gonna work. I mean, how can they dance like this? Then they would do one step onto the stage, and the body would just go boom.
Still.
Completely still. That's the control they had on that water, on their cold water that day. It was amazing to watch. I kept cheering.
And enjoy this one, which is a total different adventure, a total different approach, and again, it's pure bliss, and keep it inside your heart for the rest of the evening and forever. And yes, rethink energy.